Here we go. 'Cause I was lost. you our praise. You are worthy of our song. In the blessings and the breakings, we give it to you, Lord. It doesn't matter our circumstances. It doesn't matter what comes our way. You're worthy of everything.
My eyes have seen the King of glory. Oh, I'll never be the same. So now I live to tell my story. This is it. Jesus is the only way, right? Jesus is the only way.
Come on, sing this out.
I'm gonna burn bright. I'm gonna let
just one light to shine like stars.
rejoice, 'cause you're there too. I won't be far from my fears. I hold fast to what is true. And if that cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Come on, 'cause death is just the doorway into resurrection. You believe that? And if I join you in your service, then I'll join you.
dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who come to the Father.
Come on, this is us.
And the church of Christ was born.
That is here with us today. And God, we come in with expectation in our hearts, God, that the Holy Spirit is here, and God, He's ready to speak, He's ready to move, He's ready to heal, He's ready to redeem and restore, God. So Father, we bring our praise and our adoration, God, into your presence, Lord. You are worth, God, every lyric. You're worth every lifted hand, God, every shout of praise. You are worth it all, Jesus. So we bring our praise and our thanksgiving into your house today. God, bless us as we receive your word later on. May your presence continue to move. And God, may everyone here know and watching online know that they are loved deeply by their heavenly Father. In Jesus' name. And the church said, amen, amen. Come on, can we give God praise one more time in the house of the Lord? Hey, if you're watching online, we're so glad you're tuned in this morning. You're going to be blessed by today's service here in the worship center. Why don't you turn and greet somebody? Thank you so much once again for coming to Brightmoore.
Good morning, Brightmoor. I'd like to say good morning to all the people that decided to not go up north or to go to the west side of the state or maybe to stay home. Hey, welcome to the house of the Lord today. Come on, give yourself a round of applause. It's great to have you on this Labor Day weekend. I don't know about you, but I have already been laboring all weekend. I've cleaned up cars. I've cleaned out garages. How many know that's what Labor Day weekend's for, right? And we'll rest later on. But what a joy it is to have you here on this holiday weekend. Thanks for joining us. Hey, before I welcome everybody online and welcome you in the worship center, can we welcome back our team from Romania that landed yesterday? So what a joy it is to have them back. It is exciting to see what God has done. I just sat in my prayer time yesterday and I was just overwhelmed with thanksgiving for how God has trusted our church to reach the lost. Can you say amen to that? That He trusted us in Puerto Rico, He trusted us in El Salvador, He trusted us in the Dominican, He trusted us in Romania, He trusted us in Jolo, West Virginia. How many of you know He's gonna trust us with Farmington Hills and Novi and Redford and Milford and Detroit? Come on, somebody say amen, because that's what it's all about. So we say welcome to the Romanian team, and I know like in about 5 or 6 weeks, the second team is going to go out. So we're excited about that and continue to build upon it and continue to lift up what God is doing in our midst. Of course, if you're watching us online, we'd like to give a special thank you. I know a lot of our family is away and they're watching us maybe up north or on the west side, or maybe you're on vacation, but maybe you're watching us for the first time or the second time. There's a phone number that's going to come up, 248-780-7807. And I would love for you to personally take a moment. And to that phone number, if you're new, text the word new. If you've been watching for a while and you want to connect to somehow the church life online, we'll have digital Bible studies coming up and all of that. You can text the word connect. But most importantly, if you need prayer, text the word prayer. We'll definitely reach back out to you. Those of you that are here in the worship center, if you're visiting with us on this holiday weekend, we say welcome. And in front of you in one of the chairs, there is a connect card that looks like this. If you take a moment and fill out that information, we would greatly appreciate it. You can do it manually with the pen that is there, or you can scan it with your phone and fill it out digitally. But either way that you choose to do, the important step is that following this service, take about 2 minutes. If you don't mind, there's a guest reception area that is located right by the Welcome Center. They would love for you to come. You can tell them I filled it out digitally, or you can bring the card to them, however you did it. They'll give you more information about our church and how you can get involved, maybe some of the things that we offer that might interest you. But if you go that route, we'll give you a gift card for you and everybody that came with you today for a free item out of the Brightmoor Cafe. Today is the first Sunday of September. I mean, where did June, July? You're clapping. Y'all live in Michigan. You know what that means, don't you? I mean, where did June, July, and August disappear to? But it is the first Sunday, which means that Grow Track Know God Week 1 is happening. If you've never gone through Grow Track, we encourage you to do it. We offer it every Sunday. It's a 4-week learn our values, learn our philosophy of ministry, learn our doctrine, pathway to baptism, membership, all of that. So make sure that you're part of Grow Track if you don't mind. Kids Night Out. That's going to be coming up in about a week on September 9th, 6:30 to 9:30. I think there's already over 100 kids signed up for it, so you want to make sure you get those kids and grandkids part of it. It's going to be a great time for them as well. Ladies, you in about 2.5 weeks, you have a conference that is coming. I will, and it's going to be fantastic. Over 1,200 ladies have already registered for it, so we want to make sure that you're part of that. And if you do need financial assistance, you can definitely see Jennifer Heater out there in the lobby. We'd love to come alongside you and help you, but it's going to be a fantastic weekend. Make sure that you're signing up. Make sure that you're part of it. Bring a friend with you. I think that they will have a tremendous time together. Married Life, you're going to be having a game night coming up on September 23rd from 6:30 to 9:30. It'll be a great time to come together. If you don't have friends, get some community around here. Pastor Rob and Sherry will be leading that. And this Wednesday, Bistro starts back. So I don't know how excited. There's about 8 of you that are excited for it. And September 7th is taco night. So how about that? So how many of you love tacos? There you go. So come on out. It's a great opportunity that you don't have to cook dinner on Wednesday. You can come here beginning, I believe, at like 5:30, 6 o'clock. You can come. You can have a meal for your family at a very reduced rate to be able to do that. And then you can slide right into the ministries of the church. But you can see what's taking place. Grow Track, as I mentioned a minute ago, is going to have a one-day Grow Track where they're going to combine all four sessions on Saturday, October 1st. So if you're unable to do the Sunday Grow Track, let me encourage you. Come be part of the one-day Grow Track. It's going to be on October 1st, Saturday, beginning at 9 a.m. You'll be out by 12:30, so you'll still have a lot of your day. I know school started, so next week we want to just remind all of our teachers and those that are in the education that we're going to be praying for you next week. We'll have a gift for you as well. So if you know teachers, we want to take a moment and recognize them. How many know they got a pretty tough job? And how many know that they need our prayers too as well? And so as we have been doing this for probably 10 years or more, we're going to pray for our educators and we're going to pray for those that are in the administration. If you have any involvement in education in that capacity, make sure that you're here for one of the services. We want to call you forward. We want to pray with you and you'll join well over 100 people that'll be part of that. So it'll be an exciting time to do that. And of course, coming up in a couple of weeks, we're going to begin our fall Bible studies. You can see the information that's there. You can go to our website. There's life groups, there's women groups, men's group, leadership, financial peace, young adult groups, and you can sign up at brightmorechurch.org/discipleship. But get involved in one of those groups. You know, the church is large, but the church has to get smaller too as well. So you need to form friendships. You need to form community. This is one of the ways to be able to do it, is to get into one of the Bible studies or to get into one of the groups as well. Thank you. I appreciate that. So one last thing. Thank you for your giving, your tithes and offerings. We try to make giving easy. You can do it in person. There are offering envelopes in front of you, drop boxes on your way out. You can do it off of our app, in the mail. You can do it off of Secure Give, however you choose. Thank you for your generosity in giving to the Lord. Now, our first Wednesday night of November will be our family meeting, as we call it. Maybe the older term is a business meeting, where we will release all the financials from last year. What did we do in giving? What did we do in tithes and offerings? What did we do in our mortgage and all that? Can I just celebrate with you, since y'all came on a holiday weekend? Can I celebrate with you? One of like 10 things we're going to be telling you at our family meeting. Last year alone, we paid over $3 million off our mortgage for the first time. I say praise God for that. I mean, come on, somebody say amen. Supernaturally, miraculously, we are on a pathway to be completely debt-free. And instead of me standing here and saying, we paid $3 million off the mortgage, how about this? We gave $3 million to missions. We gave $3 million to the local ministries, because that Brightmoor is right around the corner. So stay faithful. There's so many other things we're going to be able to celebrate on that. But we are going to have election for deacons. If you would like to nominate, you're a member, you'd like to nominate, the information is out there at the Welcome Center. And you can make a nomination that will be taken into consideration if you'd like to. But we want to make sure that you're doing that. And it's a very important business meeting. Why? We're going to make some constitutional changes. We've only done this one other time since I had been here in 17 years, but there are a few things. How many know with times changing, the Constitution gets a little old? Hey, we have a Constitution, but we also have a Bill of Rights also, that they've made addendums and amendments and things. So in our time, we feel like we need to make some changes in the Constitution. One of them was that the deacon board and the senior pastor can take emergency powers if there is the event of a national disaster or another pandemic. How many know what I'm talking about? So it's simple things like that. We'll make sure that you get all the information of what we're looking to do 2 or 3 weeks prior to the meeting by obeying our Constitution and bylaws. But it'll be great. So it'll be a great annual business meeting, our family meeting. So you want to make sure that you guys are going to be part of it. Aren't you excited about your church? I'm excited to preach, I can tell you that, so I can feel it shut up in my bones. So here we go. Let's pray. Let's ask the Spirit to give us ears to hear and a heart to understand. Amen. So we're going to spend a little bit more time in Acts 19 this week and potentially Next week, we're also going to stay in Acts 19, and then we're going to be into Acts 20, which I'm excited. So Heavenly Father, I thank you for the Brightmore family. I thank you for their generosity. I thank you, Lord, that we can rejoice at how significantly last year we've been able to address our mortgage. Lord, we look forward to a day that every dime that is paid off the brick and mortar is going to go to missions. It's going to build churches around the world. It's going to support missionaries. Come on, Brightmore, are you with me on this? Lord, so I pray that a spirit of generosity would still be upon our family so that we can lay up treasures in heaven where rust and moth cannot get into and thieves cannot break in and take it away from us. And so, Lord, you keep a record of all of that. So may we continue to stay faithful. And in that process, I pray that the windows of heaven would be opened up over my Brightmore family, that you would bless them and pour out a blessing upon them that they cannot contain. I pray for our business owners as well. Continue to help them, Lord, to be able to manage well, lead well. And I pray, Father, that they would prosper as they give unto you. And now, Lord, by the Holy Spirit that we have invited, as we even sang in that last song, when the Spirit lit the church on fire. Lord, that's what we've been talking about all through the book of Acts. And that we continue that fire that was lit in Acts chapter 2 when it says that cloven tongues of fire and suddenly the sound of a mighty rushing wind fell on the 120 that were in the upper room and it changed the world. May the same cloven tongues of fire and the same mighty rushing wind blow through the people of Brightmore as well that we receive, Lord. And so I pray this now over my Brightmore family. We ask now, ears to hear and a heart to understand, for we ask it now. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody says, amen. Amen and amen. Okay, part two of last week. Thank you, Amber, filling in for Pastor Solomon. Does a great job of doing that. Acts chapter 19, part two, when the gospel is proclaimed. I don't know about you, but I've thoroughly enjoyed going through the book of Acts since the very beginning of the year. Have you not enjoyed it? Have you not had a better understanding? And last week we started our adventure because when we get to Acts 19, the Apostle Paul now arrives at that great ancient city of Ephesus, which is now in modern day Turkey today. It was here that Paul really has now, as I would say, begins to stand strong in the Spirit. That he has now gone through his first missionary journey. He has now gone through his second missionary journey. He's now on his third missionary journey. He has already been rebuffed at the Areopagus with the Stoic philosophers, if you can recall our time. He's already been in Iconium and Lystra and Derbe. He's already been in Corinth. He's already had a disagreement with his best friend in Barnabas at the separation. Paul has seen himself in prison and miraculously set free. By the time you get to Acts 19, Paul is not a preacher with style. Paul is a sturdy, Holy Ghost-filled man that is able to withstand the onslaught of the kingdom of darkness. That's the kind of church we have got to become. I'm telling you, the days will grow darker and more evil, but that gives the church a greater opportunity to stand in the power and in the blood of Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen. By the time he's in Ephesus, you remember that the city is completely gripped in the hands of Satan with superstition, demonism, darkness. It's a place of sorcery, a place of black magic. In Ephesus, they had, whoa, there you go. They had a darkness. It was light up here on the platform. That's all I can tell you. I was in the light. By the time you get to Ephesus, there's a temple to Artemis. We'll talk about that next week. And next week, I'm going to talk a little bit about idolatry that has taken place today and draw some correlations from the people in Ephesus. This temple was so grand and so magnificent to Artemis that it was known as one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. But the major problem that Paul will encounter is that Ephesus is the epicenter of the magical arts. It's the epicenter right now of people casting spells, people that are filled with literal demons from hell. Now, I know some of you are going to say, oh, he's going to talk about that. Yes, I am going to talk about it because they are real, and I'm going to prove it by the Bible. And like what Paul always does, and you got to appreciate him, that man who they say was bow-legged and not that tall, that's kind of the church historical representation of him, he assaults the stronghold. How many of you know the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church? And gates don't attack. We are on the offensive. We put on the full armor of God, and there's no protection from the back. There is the sword of the Spirit, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith. How many know we are marching as to war? Some of you are like, well, I don't want no spiritual warfare. Then you don't want to be in the kingdom. And whether you recognize it or not, you're in warfare. So it is here that Paul will actually write back to them and say, what does he say? For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against the powers and against the rulers of the darkness of this age. How many of you know that he's writing to them these words when you understand that they're steeped in black magic? That's why he writes to them and says that. But let's look at it. Let's pick up the story, quick review, and then to the new points. Acts 19, verse 8. Paul entered the synagogue. Let's say it together. Where? At Ephesus. And spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them. He took his disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. And God did extraordinary miracles through Paul so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick and their illnesses were cured and the evil spirits left them. Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus. I'm going to prove that what they were trying to do was to use the name of Jesus as an invocation in spell casting. That's what they're trying to do. So they're thinking that I can cast this spell. When I saw Paul's power, what it says is that what? Some Jews went around driving out evil spirits, tried to invoke, as in a spell, the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. And they would say, in the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches, I command you to come out. 7 sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. The evil spirit answered them, boy, when the devil talks back to you, Jesus I know, and I know about Paul, but who in the world are you? If that ever comes your way, you better start running. That's all I'm going to say. Then the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them and overpowered them. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. When this became known to the Jews, when what? When the debacle of the 7 sons of Sceva became known. When this became known to the Jews and Greeks living in Ephesus, they were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord Jesus was held in honor. Many of those who believed now came and openly confessed their evil deeds. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. In this way, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. Now, there are lessons for us to learn, five of them that I had written down, that when the gospel is proclaimed, this is what happens. Last week we said, number one, just review, when the gospel is proclaimed, it will always be met with opposition and a rejection of the truth. You saw it there. Paul entered the synagogue, spoke boldly for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. Some of them became obstinate. Some of them refused to believe. Some of them publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them. Here is a picture of spiritual warfare between the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. These Jews chose to harden their hearts, resulting in disobedience and then lying about the truth of God that is found in Jesus Christ. It was last week that I told you, it is not the heart of the lost that is out there that concerns me. It's the hard heart of the found that sit in church all the time. Remember that. Remember, what does it say again as you see Acts 19, 8 through 10, you can see the part that I underlined for sake of time. They refused. Everybody say that, and I can hear them online. They refused. In other words, they willingly chose this. They deliberately decided. They made a conscious decision that what we're hearing from Paul, we will not implement into our lives. And Brightmore, if it can happen to them under the preaching of the greatest apostle in Paul, it can happen to us under the preaching of some 5'8" guy out of Louisiana. It can happen to us as well. Let him who think he stand take heed, amen, lest he fall. And we talked about it was a 3-month process. Rarely do people get up and say, I'm against the gospel. Rarely do people get up and just say, I'm willfully turning my back today. Anyone you know got up and just said, I'm turning my back today on the Lord. But they've drifted away through time. They have fulfilled what Hebrews 2 and 1 says what? We must pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard. Listen, if you're in church or you're watching online, this ain't the time to do your grocery list. This isn't the time for you to be daydreaming about what your college football team did. Listen, Michigan State and Michigan played high school teams this weekend. They should have won. The big games ain't here yet. So you should not let your mind drift, because it's in this moment right now that the enemy wants your mind to daydream away. Pastor's long, pastor's loud, pastor, oh, blah, blah, blah. I don't like the person sitting next to me. How many? Listen, you cannot drift. This, to me, is more important than any other part of the service, is for you to hear the word of God. So don't be careless and drift in your Bible reading. Don't be careless and drift away in your praying or in your serving or in your giving. I noticed how the amens were real big and then it just got a little less, little less. And by the time I get to giving, I got one, Tawana, amen. Don't drift in your attending church as well. The Bible says, forsake not the fellowship, the gathering of the brothers and sisters. You cannot do this alone. Watch me online. You can't sit for years in your pajamas sipping your coffee and think you're going to grow in the same context that you would grow if you were here. I say, listen, I'm going to say it in love because I love you and I'm a watchman on the wall. And I'm not here to make everybody feel good. I'm here to grow you spiritually. So, guard your heart. It's what Proverbs 4 says. Above all else. Above all else. Before you make an investment, above all else, guard your heart. Before you choose your spouse, above all else, guard your heart. Before you decide what school to go to, above all else, guard your heart. And why does he say that? Because from the heart flows everything from life. So, don't be careless. I'm not a flight attendant. You remember that illustration? Enough said. Number two, when the gospel is proclaimed, faith arises and supernatural events happen. Look at verse 11. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick and their illnesses were cured and evil spirits left them. When the gospel is preached, supernatural things begin to happen. Supernatural salvations happen. Supernatural restoration in marriages happen. Supernatural healing happens. Supernatural breaking of addictions happen. How many understand what I'm talking about? Like we sing this song, this is a house of miracles. Is it or is it not? When you walk in, do you believe that this is the house of miracles? When you drive in and you see that 65-foot cross, do you say unto yourself, from Calvary flows healing, from Calvary flows forgiveness, from Calvary flows redemption, from Calvary flows peace, from Calvary flows every good and perfect gift. So we challenged ourselves last week that he has power over the natural world. Don't have time to give you all the scriptures. He has power over physical ailments. Don't want to give you all the scriptures. Has power over the kingdom of darkness. Can't give you all the scriptures like last week. He also has power over death, hell, and the grave. Can't give you all the scriptures. But I can say this. When the gospel is proclaimed, faith rises and supernatural events happen. Right? And that's the church we're going to be part of. Right? All right. That's the church I want. Number three. New stuff now. Number three. You guys ready? And it's Labor Day. And I've labored, so I'm going to let you guys out early. Thanks, Angie. I appreciate that. She's like, woo, we're going home early. Nothing to go home to. No football. Well, there is. LSU plays tonight. But number three, when the gospel is proclaimed, there will be attempts to counterfeit the truth. Isn't that right? When the God, I see it right there. Don't you see it? What happens? Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon possessed. They would say, in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, I command you to come out. Seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. The evil spirit answered them, Jesus I know, and I know about Paul, but who in the world are you? When the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them, overpowered them all. That's seven men. And one guy possessed, remember the demon-possessed guy in the Gennesaret area? They had chains. He was in a cave. They couldn't even contain him at that moment. Oh, but Jesus could. I'm going to talk about that. You guys ready to get your shout on here in a moment? Because I love it. Overpowered them all seven. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. How many know that's a beating? Now, I've been beat before, but I never ran out of the house naked and bleeding, okay? My parents beat me a couple of times. Now, some of you are going to be like, that ain't right. Hey, spare the rod, spoil the child. I'm not about child abuse. How you got to put so many disclaimers nowadays? Just obey the Bible. Rebellion is in the heart of the child, and the rod will drive it far from them. I mean, I'm just saying, you want to know why society's all messed up? It's because we've inverted parents from top leadership to bottom leadership, and we put the kids on the top. The kids rule the house. Since when did that never happen at 3025 Nikki Lynn Drive? My mom, you'll see it. My mom was about this tall. She ran the roost. I can just tell you that. He gave them such a beating. I digress now. Let me get back on task. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. When this became known to the Jews and the Greeks living in Ephesus, they were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord Jesus was held in high honor. Now remember, in Ephesus, this is a epicenter, big place where there was magic and spells that were being cast. So they see the power of Jesus being proclaimed through the Apostle Paul, and some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists decide that they're going to add the name of Jesus to their incantations. So what they're trying to do is, maybe if I could borrow from William Shakespeare, double, double, boil and trouble, fire burn and cauldrons bubble, in the name of Jesus, come out. But there's no power, no relationship behind him. They think that his name is some magic charm. They think it's just part of a spell that all you can do is flippantly say, in the name of, hey, if it was that much, in the name of Jesus, put a Bentley out in the parking lot for me. I mean, if it was that, it's not that easy. Listen, Jesus isn't your genie. You don't rub a lamp and then command him to do it. Jesus isn't your good luck charm that you hang from your rear view mirror. Jesus isn't your sophisticated rabbit's foot. That name's a holy name. That name's a righteous name. That name's a beautiful name. That name's a powerful name. That name is a healing name. That name is above every name, the name of Jesus. So what happens is, when these itinerant Jewish exorcists call on the name of Jesus, it becomes quite humorous to us 21 centuries later. This particular demon, or demons, is really not impressed with the seven sons of Sceva. The demons didn't like to be ordered around by such fakes and phonies, such charlatans. So the demons respond, Jesus we know, and we have heard about Paul, but I love, tell me again, who are you? Because we know Jesus and we tremble. We know Paul and we have fought that guy and have lost. But who in the world are you? Actually, two different Greek words are used right here. There's the Greek word gnosko, which is indicative presence, which means that when the demons say, Jesus, I know, they say it like this. Oh, we know Jesus. We know him. Like, there's no doubt about, we know Jesus. And then they use a different word, epistema, which means, in the use of Paul, we know Jesus and we're acquainted with Paul. Like, we're understanding who he is. He hasn't been around, since the beginning of time, like Jesus has. And the reaction of the demons is not what those exorcists had expected. The demons, working through this demon-possessed man, attack the Jewish exorcists, beat them rather badly, sends them running from their house, fleeing with blood. I mean, how many know you're beat up bad when you're bleeding? I mean, it says they were bleeding and they were naked. I mean, he took their clothes. Talk about humiliation, right? It's humiliation. Do the demons in hell, are they acquainted with you? I mean, when they get together and they have their little council, do they ever say, like, yeah, you know exactly where I'm going, don't you? He's like, Lord, have mercy right now. I wonder if they ever say, yeah, we know that church Brightmore. We know what happens when those prayer partners get up there. We know. We're acquainted with what is happening. Do you think that they know who you are in God's kingdom because of what you are doing? Do you think that they say, like, that's a man of God, that's a woman of faith, that's a prayer warrior, we got to be careful here? I mean, listen, you can conjecture in the white spots of the Bible that they do have conversations, because they did say, Jesus we know and Paul we're acquainted with. Do they have any acquainting with you? It should be evident from these verses. And hear me. that casting out demons or spiritual warfare is not something that should be undertaken lightly and casually. Don't rush in where angels fear to trod. The fascination today in Christian circles with the exorcising of demons is without biblical support, and it's dangerous. Hear me on it. We say things like this when we talk about the enemy. Struggling to make ends meet on their first-time salary, a pastor was livid when he confronted his wife with a receipt of $250 for a dress that she had bought. The preacher said to his wife, "How could you do this?" And the wife said, "Well, I was outside the store looking at the dress in the window, and I then found myself trying it on," she explained. "It was like Satan whispered in my ear, 'Girl, you look fabulous in that dress. Buy it.'" And the preacher said, "Well, you know how to deal with that kind of temptation and the enemy. You say, 'Get thee behind me, Satan.'" To which the pastor's wife replied, "I did say, 'Get thee behind me, Satan.'" And then he said, "Girl, you look fabulous from behind here too. So I bought it." Now, there are moments that you can laugh at things like that. It's okay, but listen to me clearly out of Acts 19. The devil, spiritual warfare, demonism is not something to take lightly. What did Jesus say about him in John 10:10? What? "The thief only comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy." Listen, he's laid out his plan. He didn't come to be your drinking buddy. He didn't come to be your porn-looking buddy. He didn't come to be your embezzlement buddy. He's not going to smoke a joint with you. How many know what I'm talking about? Get me in this. He's not your friend. He masquerades as an angel of light, but ultimately what he wants to do is to steal from you, is to kill you, and to destroy you. That's exactly what he wants to do. Now, some of you are going, "Well, I don't believe in the devil." Well, you don't listen to me. Listen to D.L. Moody, who was a great evangelist, and he said, "I believe in the devil for two reasons. First, the Bible teaches it. And secondly," he says, "I have done business with him." And when he said business, it wasn't a business transaction. He meant I have battled him. I have been in war with him. In Brightmore, it is every pastor's responsibility to equip the flock to engage in this spiritual war, but to engage in it on God's terms, in God's way, through the power of his word, through the blood of the lamb, through the testimony of the saints, and you do it on God's term, dressed in the full armor of God. So, hold on and get ready to start writing some scriptures down. Peter warns us all, does he not? Peter says in 1 Peter 5:8, "Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." Today, our American culture is more interested in spiritual phenomenons such as zombies, ghosts, poltergeists, spiritual animals, channeling, crystals. They are more interested in those things than they are in the biblical view of the supernatural. Therefore, as your pastor, I have to teach us how to engage biblically into spiritual warfare that is there. Now, remember, one of the greatest thinkers in the 20th century was a man named C.S. Lewis. You know him. He wrote the Chronicles of Narnia. He wrote a great book called Mere Christianity. He wrote an awesome book that you need to read. It's called The Screwtape Letters. If you haven't read it, you need to read it because it's the perspective of warfare that comes our way from the enemy. Listen to an excerpt from The Screwtape Letters. He writes this: "There are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. They themselves are equally pleased with both errors and hail a materialist or a magician with the same delight. Did you get it? Did you get what C.S. Lewis says? One is to not believe, and the other is to believe so much that you're just infatuated with zombies and ghosts and poltergeists and the occult that is out there. And while the Bible says much more about God and humans, it does speak about angels and demons and that they do exist, and we need to know something about them. And listen to me, Brightmore, don't get worried for a moment. Don't get worried for a moment. God alone is the self-existent, eternal creator of the universe. Not for a moment. There's no power that rivals his omnipotence. There's no knowledge that rivals his omniscience. Listen, you sing about it often when we sing that great worship song, What a Beautiful Name. When it goes, you have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Why? Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. Outside of God, everything else is created. A creature. Not on the level of our God. Zippo. Nunca. Nothing. And besides making humans in his image and likeness, body and soul and spirit, God created angels as well. Now, there is some in the scriptures that talk about them, not much about their origin, but we are told that prior to time, some angels rebelled against God in heaven, and there was a war in heaven. How many know what I'm talking about? There was a war. Some of them rebelled, and they were led by Lucifer, the worship leader in heaven, who said in Isaiah, I will ascend to his throne, and I will be like the Most High. Bro, bad mistake. Those who did not rebel against God are now angels, God's servants, who obey God by declaring his revelation, such as Gabriel declaring the birth of Jesus, such as the archangel Michael, who does the fighting for God. They fight dark angels in Daniel 10. They protect followers in Psalms 34 and in Psalms 91. They worship God himself in Isaiah chapter 6. There's the seraphim and the cherubim that fly to and fro with six wings, singing what? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And they never stop. Be encouraged that you might have a guardian angel. How do I know? Hebrews 1 and 14. Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation? Jesus said this of Lucifer, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. It wasn't a quick, or wait, it wasn't a long process. It wasn't a big struggle. When he rebelled, God said, that's it. And like lightning, he was kicked out. Revelation speaks of Satan as a dragon who fights against God's angels, is thrown out of heaven with his own fallen angels. He's referred to as the ancient serpent in Genesis 3. When Jesus warned those who falsely claimed that they followed him, he said in Matthew 25 and 41, depart from me, you who are cursed, into eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Peter writes in 2 Peter 2 and 4, God did not spare angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell, putting them in chains of darkness to be held for judgment. Jude writes in his little postcard in Jude verse 6, the angels who did not keep their position of authority, but abandoned their proper dwelling, those he has kept in darkness bound with everlasting chains for judgment on the great day. Satan and demons are invested in deception deception and falsehood propaganda. Jesus refers to Satan himself in John 8:44, for he is the father of lies. And when he speaks his native tongue. Paul speaks of his work in 2 Corinthians 4:4. For the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Paul then warns us in 2 Corinthians 11. And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. It's not surprising then if his servants also masquerade as servants of righteousness. Therein will be what their actions deserve. Listen to me. A lot is said about angels and fallen angels that are there. It's biblically true. I'm going to say it. Some of what you're facing is literally an attack from the enemy in your own life. And you're just now opening your spiritual eyes to begin to see that. And some of the things that you're going through is not going to be resolved by man. It's going to be resolved by the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit that is inside of you. I know that demons can affect and afflict people, as seen in Jesus' interaction with many people in the gospel. It happens today. But demonic influences may be more subtle today. So Christians need to be alert of their wiles without becoming paranoia. Don't walk around and go, oh, there's a demon in you. Okay, stop that stuff. The point I'm trying to make is the point in Acts 19 is making of the seven sons of Sceva is this: spiritual warfare is real. The devil is real. And no one can stand up against the demons or devils on their own power. I know some of you are going like, this is so archaic, this is so ancient. I'm sorry, I'm not intellectually sophisticated like some of you are. But the devil showed up in Genesis 3. And he's been showing up in every season of life since that moment. I'm just letting you know. And some of you might be asking yourself, well, Pastor Jamie, have you ever encountered demon possession? And my answer is yes. I have twice, once in the country of Costa Rica and the other on the island of Zanzibar, steeped in their traditions. And I can't tell you for sake of time what happened in both of those places, but in Costa Rica, we were in a church service. There was a lady that was possessed of a devil that came in. She manifested herself. Supernatural strength was there. Me and the pastor had her on the ground, writhing, foaming, literally at her mouth, speaking in a language that we did not understand. I looked up at all the kids. It was a youth missions trip. And I said, if you're not full of the Holy Spirit, you need to leave this place right now. They all jumped up and ran to the bus as fast as they possibly could. But I have seen literal demon possession. And I know some of you are going to be like, that's so cray cray. No, it's not. I'm just telling you. And let me just add a few more things. Since we're talking about Ephesus and casting spells and black magic and the arts and all of that, dabbling with the occult is dangerous. You need to hear me in love. There is no such thing, and I've said it, I'll say it one last time. Maybe not, probably not. There are no good witches. Horoscopes, astrology, palm reading, tarot cards. Listen, they're not of God. Listen to me with a clarion voice as the bell is rung. I don't care if you're a Leo, a Taurus, a Scorpion. I don't care if you're a Pisces, a Gemini, a Capricorn. I don't care if it's the dawning of your Aquarius that is happening. I want to know, is Jesus Lord of your life? Are you saved? Are you covered by the blood of the Lamb? Are you full of the Holy Spirit? What I want you to know is that, do you believe the Bible? Because your astrological sign is not going to give you true direction. Your horoscope does not give you guidance. That palm reader is not getting their information from God. They are led by hell. You need to know is that the Bible is true, and if you stand upon the Bible, your life will be fine. I don't know. I'm not even done with point three. I got more. We might have to do a part three next week on this one here. I don't know. Because let me tell you what, there are a few things that the devil does not want you to be aware of. You know that? He wants to keep information from you because information is power, right? Right? We know that. The devil doesn't want you to know the truth about him. Right? What's the truth about him? James 4:7. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. That's the truth about him. He doesn't want you to know the truth of Romans 16:20. And the God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with you. Amen. He doesn't want you to know the truth of Revelation chapter 12. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceived the whole world. He was cast to the earth and his angels were cast out with him. And then I heard a loud voice saying from heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of God and the power of Christ has come. For the accuser of the brethren who has accused them before our God day and night has been cast down, and they overcame. Came and by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. He doesn't want you to know the truth of what Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 5. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion seeking who he may devour. Resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same suffering you are experiencing by your brotherhood in the world. He doesn't want you to know the truth of 1 John 4:4. For you are God's little children and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in. Oh, somebody say amen. He doesn't want you to know the truth of John 3:8. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. So that's what he doesn't want you to know about him. And I'm only pausing to catch my breath. Because Satan doesn't want you to know that you have nothing to fear. Amen. Stop walking around in fear. Amen. Isaiah 41:10. He doesn't want you to know, fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, and yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. He doesn't want you to know the truth of Luke 10:19. Behold, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all powers of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall hurt you. He doesn't want you to know 2 Timothy 1:7. For God has not given you a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. He doesn't want you to know you have nothing to fear. I'm not done. He doesn't want us to know about the power we have access to. Romans 8:31, what then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He doesn't want you to know Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. He doesn't want you to know 1 Corinthians 10. No temptation has overtaken you except such as common to man. But God is faithful. But God is faithful. Listen, but God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with each temptation will also make a way of escape so that you may be able to bear it. You can't say the devil made me do it. Why? Because in every temptation, God has given you a pathway out of that temptation. He doesn't want you to know that. Well, I'm not done. He doesn't want you to know the promises that you have in Jesus either. What are some of them? Oh, let me give you the most famous. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. He doesn't want you to know Colossians 1:13. What? For the Lord has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed or brought us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood and forgiveness of sin. He doesn't want you to know the promise of Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made us free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on the account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. He doesn't want you to know Galatians 2. For I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. He doesn't want you to know the truth of Romans 10:9-10. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. He doesn't want you to know the promise of Romans 5:8, but God demonstrated his own love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He doesn't want you to know the promise of Psalms 103, as far as the east is from the west, so I have removed our transgressions from us. So what am I saying? So what I'm saying is when the gospel is proclaimed, there will be attempts to counterfeit it. Don't be deceived by the counterfeit. Keep your spiritual heart and your mind open. Acts 19 also tells me that playing around with the occult and demons and the devil with trifle talk is unwise. The name of Jesus is not an incantation. It's a powerful name. For some of you, listen, you're in a spiritual battle, a spiritual warfare. Go back and listen. Write these scriptures down. Read them to yourself each and every day. And arm yourself. Because Jesus we know. And Paul we've heard about. But I want him to know me. And I want him to know Brightmore. And I want them to know all of you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen? That's probably the longest point in history. Point four. When the gospel is proclaimed, there will always be conviction of sin. Now, I want to talk about this because many preachers, many churches drive for all this acceptance, make you feel good. And what we have lost is the spirit of conviction, not condemnation. Condemnation, and to tell the difference between condemnation and conviction, is condemnation is just a generalized thing that you would feel. You're no good. You're unworthy. You're a loser. You know, that's condemnation. Conviction is, stop talking to your spouse that way. Conviction is specific. Stop being greedy and stingy. That's specific. So there's a difference in it. But notice what happens when the gospel is proclaimed. It says in verse 18, many of those who believed now came and openly confessed their evil deeds. How many know if a demon manifests himself here, beat about seven of you guys up, you're running out of here bloody and naked, the rest of us are going to be at the altar repenting? How many know we're going to be like, Jesus, help me, right? Amen. So many of them now believed, came openly, confessed their evil deeds. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. Let me give you an account of actually how much that really is. A drachma is a one-day wage. So 50,000 drachma is the expense of what would have been burned up in the magic scrolls and the parchment that took place on that day. So if you made $50,000, let's just put that as a medium line. If you made $50,000, that means that on that day, they burnt up $6,850,000 worth of sin. Spells. If you made $50,000 and you had to pay for it all yourself, it would take you 137 years to get there. I mean, that's a long time. So as a result of the shaming of the seven sons of Sceva, a great conviction of sin now falls on the city and the church that is there in Ephesus. When they see that the power of God through the Apostle Paul prevails over the power of magic. You guys getting it? When it sees that the power of God prevails over the power of the magic that is there through the failed sons of Sceva, the Ephesians now see their magical practices for what they truly were. They now know that their magical practices are evil and worthless. So eventually, what has ended up happening is there are people that are part of the synagogue or people that are part of the church, hear me on this, who have professed to be followers of Jesus Christ, but they kept holding on to a part of the magical arts they didn't want to let go. So now they have to come and openly confess. Every deed done in darkness will eventually be brought into the light. I mean, isn't that scriptural? I mean, that's why some of us, and I say me included, I get on my knees and I'm saying, dear Lord Jesus, the blood of Jesus, cover me, forgive me, cleanse me. So what ends up happening is that there are people in the synagogue or people in the church that have secret sins. So all of a sudden, they're confronted going, oh my goodness. I have a foot in the kingdom of light and a foot in the kingdom of darkness. And they gathered up all that they had and they openly confess, I'm in the wrong. I've held this sin that nobody has known about. And I need forgiveness of it. I need to be set free from this. I now recognize that these spells and these incantations, they're powerless. They're worthless against the kingdom of Jesus. And they openly confess. I mean, how many of you would think it would be odd if I had put up a microphone now and just say, like, let's have open confession right now? That's nervous laughter. Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah, that's a good one, Pastor. It appears that the mighty work of God begins when the believers clean up their lives. When they divulge their hidden practices, when they confess what they were doing in private rest. Be at ease. I'm not going to call for an open mic, but I am going to call a scripture to account to all of us. When David wrote in Psalms 139 and 23, he said, search me, God, and know my heart, and test me, and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me. I put a pregnant pause here just for a moment so that you can ask the Holy Spirit to search you. That are there things that are in the dark that nobody knows about? And if it is, listen, I'm going to ask you to say, Lord, I repent of it. I turn from it. You don't need that any longer. It's worthless. It's powerless. That which strives in the kingdom of darkness can never bring true fulfillment, can never bring true satisfaction, can never bring true power to you. You need to relinquish it, repent of it, ask for the blood of Jesus to forgive you, and move away from it with some type of accountability. See, Brightmore, the goal of my preaching in my next 40 years here is not to make us feel good. The goal of my preaching is to bring conviction and to bring life change. It's to bring encouragement to follow him, not entertainment, so that you leave happy. All right, lastly, I told you I'd get out of here. I've labored. Number five is Amber will make her way back. When the gospel is proclaimed, there will always be growth in the church. Growth will be a natural byproduct. You know, I got to be honest with you. I used to, like, fret a lot. What do I mean by that? When I was early on in the ministry, I literally would beg people to come to the altar. I'd be like, hey, there's some prayer partners. Please come. Somebody please come. Please, so that I can feel like I'm valued and my preaching was worth it. And please, besides my mother, will somebody please come to the altar? And then it's the same guy that got saved like 852 times. He'd come down. But, you know, and I used to put so much pressure on myself. I mean, early on, it's a trap for preachers. Jeff, you understand that. As you led up here with Life Challenge a few weeks ago. We put this undue pressure on us that somehow we got to perform, and somehow it's going to be based then on how many people respond in that. But the Lord told me something a while ago, and that is this. You just be faithful to plant the seed and to water the seed, and then I'm going to give the increase. So guess what? So if nobody comes to the altar, I don't go home and wring my hands and go, I just go home and go, they just ain't listening to you, Lord. They're ignoring you, Lord. But I've learned this. If churches would get away from embracing just cultural success and get back to the scripture that says, if you lift Jesus high and up, he will draw all men and all women unto himself. See, Jesus doesn't need haze machines and background music. And Jesus doesn't need comfortable chairs and beautiful lights and a great kid. He doesn't need any of that. He's beautiful all on his own. He's magnanimous all on his own. Old loved him, children loved him, rich loved him, poor loved him. I mean, if we just lift him up, if we're just faithful to proclaiming the gospel and water the seeds and plant the seeds, God will bring the increase into our church. It will be just a natural byproduct. So what ends up happening is these unbelievers see these believers getting their lives right, and they're like, hey, I gotta have part of that. And that's kind of what I want. Can you imagine? I know I preached many weeks ago about Ananias and Sapphira. Remember that? About hypocrisy in the church, lying, counterfeiting in the church and all of that. Can you imagine if what took place with Ananias and Sapphira, or what took place here in Acts 19 in this ancient city of Ephesus, if that would actually happen in our church today, there would be a sweep of Holy Ghost conviction that would take place. If that kind of conviction would actually take place, I think that there would be videos and cable channels that we would no longer watch. I think business practices that are under the table would stop. I think certain websites would not be visited. I think people would ask others to pray for them to be set free. I think altars would be filled with people asking for forgiveness. The older I get, the closer I know I draw to eternity. And the same is for each and every one of us. Acts 19, it's no joke chapter. When the gospel is proclaimed, it will always be met with opposition and a rejection to the truth. There will be some people who, through a process, will deliberately and willfully say no to God. Don't be that person. When the gospel is proclaimed, faith rises and supernatural events take place. Handkerchiefs and aprons that touch Paul healed the sick and drove out evil spirits of those that had them. May we be a church of faith that sees God do extraordinary miracles in our midst. Amen. When the gospel is proclaimed, there will be an attempt to counterfeit the truth. There will be people who will try to play church instead of being the church. Don't be that person. You never know. One of them devils might get up and beat the mess out of you, and you run out of here naked and bleeding. And I can't help you there. When the gospel is proclaimed, there will be conviction of sin. Is there an element of entertainment that takes place on Sunday? Sure, you want to make sure that we present at least a friendly environment. But the most important thing is, when was the last time you felt convicted of something? We're not perfect. Have you felt? Let me talk to the mature saints. Can I do that? Do you ever feel convicted on the amount of worship you give God when you come in here? I turn around, I watch. I watch. There's some people that you've been serving Jesus for 40 years, but you're living on the worship you gave him 20 years ago. That needs to stop. You need to fall all in love with him again. You need to lift your hands again and sing again and have your heart open to him. You need to say to yourself, man, I'm convicted because when I come to church, I'm living on manna from yesterday. Yesterday's manna is full of maggots and it's rotted. That's not manna today. So that's why when we come in here, we give him our best. We're not distracted. You open your Bible. Doesn't matter if I'm 5 minutes past 10:30. When the gospel is proclaimed, conviction happens. Let judgment begin in the house of the Lord. And fifth and finally, when the gospel is proclaimed, there will always be growth in the church. May he grow his church. May he grow us spiritually, numerically, financially, emotionally. How many know you can say amen to all of that? So I'm going to invite you to stand. I'm going to invite you to stand with me. I'm going to invite our prayer partners if they would make their way down here. This is letting you out early. You do know that. If you're here today, you've rejected the truth. You've walked away. You deliberately said, hey, I'm not going to be this Christ follower. I would implore you to reconsider. To reconsider that stance. I think giving your heart to Jesus Christ is the best thing that you will ever do. It's the most important decision you'll ever do. Don't oppose him. Don't reject the truth. Don't reject the truth of God's word when it doesn't meet how you feel or your life experiences either. Let your faith arise, Brightmore. The gospel's preached. Let your faith arise. Let's believe for supernatural things. I pray for all of these men and women that stand up here. You know what I pray that God gives them? I pray that God gives them the gift of faith. So that when they join hands with you, your faith arises and supernatural things happen. This isn't a rote thing that we just go through. Now, Jesus bless them, and Jesus keep your hand upon them, and Jesus go with them, and pat, 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 we'll see you next week. No, no, no. I want to see them showing up, see things changed. Don't buy into the counterfeit. If you've dabbled with darkness, stop. Stop. No channeling, no crystals. No horoscopes, no good witches, no Miss Chloe. Oh, she died. Yep, I got that. None of that. How many know what I'm talking about? Don't dabble in that stuff. Don't be so infatuated with zombies and darkness and all of that kind of stuff. That's where culture wants you to go. When the gospel is proclaimed, conviction will fall. Don't run ever from conviction. The Bible says, those he loves, he chastens. In other words, he disciples them. If not, if he doesn't, listen, if he doesn't discipline you, he's treating you as an illegitimate child. That you're not part of his family. So when you feel that conviction, don't go like, he's being mean to me. He's being so kind to you. He's drawing you into holiness and into his presence and into the good life that you can live. And when the gospel is proclaimed, Tawana, he's going to grow his church. Amen. And And so he's going to grow us. When he grows his church, he's growing us. And that's what I want. Amen? Amen. Let me pray for you. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Thanks for joining us online as well. You need prayer, just text to that number 248-780-7807. Prayer. We'll make sure that we reach out to you and pray with you. But Father, it's with great sobriety and spiritual alertness that I now pray over my Brightmore family. It is my prayer that when the gospel is preached, there will be opposition and rejection to the truth. We see that happening. I don't even have time to get into all of it, but Heavenly Father, may we never be people that reject the truth of God, no matter if it doesn't fit our feelings, if the Word of God doesn't fit our circumstance. We can still operate out of love, but we will never willfully, openly, deliberately, proactively reject the truth of God. We will not be careless in drifting away. Lord, I pray that faith would arise within my family and supernatural things happen, and not through me alone, but through our family, through our prayer partners, through our life group leaders, through our Bible class teachers, all of that, in the lobby, in the parking lot. May faith arise and supernatural things happen. May we, Lord, put in check in our heart not to attempt to dabble with the occult or to dabble with the counterfeit that is there, but Lord, to be true to you. And I pray, Father, that as conviction falls upon our hearts in any way, that as we say, as David did in Psalm 139, search us and know our ways. See if there is any wickedness. See if there is any offense in our heart. And if there is, Lord, we repent of it, knowing that the blood of the Lamb forgives us from all unrighteousness. And Lord, grow your church. Grow your church as we proclaim the gospel. Grow us spiritually. Grow us numerically. Grow us in every capacity, Lord, in our marriages, in our parenting. Grow us in our service. Grow us because that's a natural byproduct of just proclaiming the gospel. And may we be men and women of your word. So we thank you, Lord, for this story that has been written by the physician Luke of Paul's encounter of those that were steeped in sorcery, but how the power of the kingdom of light prevailed. May we always know that we serve a very powerful God. Come on, Brightmore, let's say amen to that. Amen and amen and amen and amen. God bless you. Listen, you need special prayer. Why don't you make your way down here? If not, God bless you and have a great week. We'll see you Wednesday as I'll conclude Galatians chapter 6. God bless you.